Most so thank you very, very much. Let me just connect my okay, that's where my video is. Yeah, thank you everybody for joining this session. I see very, very nice all of you here, all the masters at PSSM and everybody.
Namaste, sir.
Namaste, namaste.
Sir, namaste. Namaste, sir. I am Vadi, editor, Jnanajagat magazine.
Okay.
I met you in 2019. I met you in
December.
Kailasapuri, Kartal, Hyderabad, in Mahila Dhyan Mahachakram.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, 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 sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I am big fan of you.
Delight.
I am a big fan of you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a delight.
So we are very, very, very happy. We don't know. Because of you, I think.
I think because of the goddesses, because of the divine energy that we're happy about. Wonderful. So, let me know and I will begin. Yeah.
Madam, you can you start the introduction, madam. Vani, madam, you can start introduction.
Shall I start?
Huh.
Yeah. Okay. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all Global Pyramid Masters. Yeah. Welcome to the Digital Swajaya Yoga Program organized by Swajaya Yoga Team India. Our beloved guest for this great event is Anand Karunesh ji from USA. Let us all welcome Anand ji with great love and joy. Hi, sir. It is my great privilege to introduce Anand Karunesh ji, also known as Sanjay Navalka, who hails from India. Anand Karunesh ji, the author of the prestigious book, 1,000 Seeds of Joy. I want to show you the book also, because wherever I go, I carry this one new book, and I will present this book to whom I am going to meet. So that wonderful book. Anand Karunesh ji has experienced Zen awakening at his age of 19, and this awakening has made him this awakening has expanded the door for him for his spiritual awareness. After that, he has engaged in meditative and spiritual practices for the past 35 years. He is the founder for a great organization, Path of Joy. This is a humanitarian organization which is dedicated in spreading the teachings of Mahadevi Lakshmi ji, Mahadevi Saraswati ji, Mahadevi Parvati ji, and all other ascended gods and goddesses of the so many religions all over the world. Anand Karunesh ji, from 2011 to 2018, he has worked as a chairman of the finance department at the Eisenberg University of Management. I think it is Eisenberg School of Management, sir. University of Massachusetts, Amherst. And then coming to this wonderful book, I just noted some points, sir. So, 1,000 Seeds of Joy, AKG, has beautifully explained in simple language about the teachings of the goddesses Lakshmi ji and goddess Saraswati ji. Through this book, he soulfully explained about the wounded feminine, wounded masculine, divine feminine, divine masculine, in question and answers format. when we read this book, we just feel that those questions are coming from the bottom of our heart. And the answers also just simply making us healed and relaxed. Okay? So, and sincerely, Anandji, you have given the world what it needs through this book. Even the epic characters in the book, like Sita, Draupadi, Radha, Mary Magdalene, and Yashodhara, and Tara, reveals such great truths to us, which can correlate them with our day-to-day life. Thanks, Anandji. After reading this book, we honestly understand that our female epic characters are not clouded with pain and grief. From our childhood, we are all reading those epics and our minds were conditioned like that. I think all our inner self was wounded by those stories. But your book, Anandji, it has cleaned all the wounds. It has healed all the wounds, Anandji. Even it sounds so good when we heard from Sita. She tells that character has been changed by the male-dominated society into a actually Sita's character is a very strong, empowered character. But the male-dominated society has been changed that character into a painful character. Okay, so in this book, through Sita, Sita herself tells that the truth, and she even laughs at that act of that male-dominated society also. And Anand Karneshji, how was it possible to you, gods and goddesses, how they laugh along with you, sir? That what we want to know.
Yes. Yeah, so.
That is so beautiful, Anandji. Thank you very much for making all the gods and goddesses reachable to us, Anandji, and laughable to us with us, and so shareable with us also. And I really enjoyed reading this wonderful book, Anandji, and felt very honored to translate some of the chapters from the book to our Telugu magazine, Dhyana Jagat. And really, I got so appreciations from the readers for those episodes, like Yashodhara, particularly for Yashodhara's character. So many has told me that they learned differently about the Yashodhara character, because nothing was written in our books about Yashodhara, only about Buddha, only they have written. And the real success behind Buddha's, the character behind Buddha's success, you have explored the character of Yashodhara, sir. And I am so thankful to Patriji also for giving me that this great opportunity to translate those chapters, sir. Now, Anandji, so many thanks. So many, many thanks for giving us this great teachings of all the gods and goddesses. Really, you made them the persons next to us, not in the pictures from our childhood. We used to see the gods and goddesses in the pictures, photo frames, are not in the sculptures. but you made them the our neighbors. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Karuneshji. And I am handing over the session to you. And I have some questions also. So, in the shall I ask you one question starting with your
sure
program? Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Sir, I would like to ask you, how can we connect to the primordial joy? Because it is a very new topic we have ever heard about the primordial joy. Just we heard about the joy and we never sensed the feeling of joy, but just we heard about the joy. But you have given the topic like primordial joy. And if you can explain us a little bit about the primordial joy, we will be happy, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vani ji. I felt your heartfelt message. I can feel the love pouring out for the divine. I can feel it in your expression. Thank you very much. I want to thank all of you for joining, and especially a big, big thanks to PSSM Global, and of course, very, very specially to Brahmashri Patriji, who has really been such a big force behind this book. When he first got it, he just has been recommending it to everybody. So a big thanks to him. It's good to see all of you. So let us, the topic of today's session is creating strength with love and joy. So to begin with, what I would like all of us to do is get a little bit more in our bodies. You know, when we are listening to a talk, we get in the head. We want to listen, we have questions and all of that, you know. But that sometimes will prevent you from listening because you already have so much in the mind you want to know, right? So take a few deep breaths and feel your body. Close your eyes, everybody, and take a deep breath. Feel it in your abdomen and breathe it out. And take your hands in and touch your feet a little bit. Touch your ankles, touch your knees. Take another deep breath. Touch your thighs, your abdomen. Breathe it out, you know. Get back in the body and breath a little bit. Touch your hands, your arms, you know. Every now and then we should touch our body like this and feel our presence being in the body, you know. And that is one of the biggest messages of these goddesses, that appreciating, honoring the body is one of the biggest sources of strengths that you can add in your life, you know. Take another deep breath in and breathe out. And a few normal breaths, get back in the body. Breath is one of the best ways to get back in the body. You will notice that when you try to feel your body and breath, there's a slight feeling of uncomfortableness in the mind because the mind has to stop its activity. That activity is that self-driven, ego-driven activity. It continues. And as you start breathing in and as you start feeling the body, there's initially you feel that slight uncomfortableness because the mind wants to continue and now it has to stop. But stay with that uncomfortableness. Keep feeling the body. And slowly you'll become more alive to the senses, to the sounds in the room, to the body sensations. Feel the gravity of your body. Feel the body is very heavy. And feel totally rested. So now we are a little bit more in our body and our breath. And so now your questions will become questions of the heart. And my answers will go deeper in your heart, because you're listening to your body. Body is the door to the soul. Mind only asks the questions. Answers come from body and soul. Mind answers are limited. They are like circular answers, depending on your assumptions. But the experiential answer, where you feel the joy, feel the love, comes from the body and soul and your higher self. So that is why we need breath. Okay, so when you're ready, you may gently open your eyes. And now let's get into the session with your questions, and we're all present. We can feel the presence. So the topic today is creating strength with love and joy. It's a wonderful topic. It's a topic that the book begins with Saraswatiji's message. She wants to add strength to love and joy, you know. How can we be strong in that? If you really think about it, true strength comes from that place only, place of love and joy. These are the highest soul feelings. You can even think of them as soul energies. The word energies is also very, very useful, because energies is physicality, you know, and also spirituality. So these energies of the soul and the universe, you know, the primordial energies are joy and love. And they're infinite. If you think about it, we understand things based upon our mind using science. So we understand that the moon, you know, is due to gravity. It is going around the earth, and earth is going around the sun. The sun is going around the Milky Way galaxy. There is a black hole. The sun is slowly moving around that. And even galaxies, we don't know. I mean, right now they think galaxies are just expanding, but even they might be moving around some center. That's not what the science says, they're just expanding. But everything is moving around everything. So what is this gravity? Is it possible that gravity is just another name for love? It is out of the free will. Everything is circling around everything. That message comes in the book, you know, regarding atoms and electrons. Everything has free will. But the free will is so dedicated, so devoted, that we understand it as laws of science. Because it never stops, you know. Earth will never stop moving around the sun. But there could be tremendous love, which comes across as gravity, tremendous, tremendous love, due to which, you know, that movement keeps happening. So everything is joined in this tremendous love, tremendous joy. Everything is connected to everything. This is why we have astrology, because when you're born, there is a deep connection with everything. The child's upper chakras are open when they are born. So they can feel completely all the planets, all the positioning, everything. And everything has a role to play. So there's an imprint made as soon as you are born, because you come out from the womb. And that imprint is powerful. It creates the way that the life will be lived. Of course, you have free will, and certain things, there is nothing deterministic completely. Planets don't mean that your life is just going to be this one particular way. But everything is connected to everything, so there is a way that is formed. There's an imprint made. And then your life will go according to that, but you can always transform it by going inward. Because joy and love, in their infinite expression, joy gets even beyond time. I mean, I don't want to introduce too many concepts, but in Einstein's relativity, time is surrendering to light. Speed of light is the only thing that is constant. Time becomes relative. But that's not how we understand time. We think time as 1 second, 2 seconds, as absolute, right? But Einstein's theory was so revolutionary because he said, no, time is not absolute. Speed of light is absolute. And so time and space bend. Speed of light remains the same. So joy is filled with this light, right? So joy is absolute. Time can bend. So you can revisit your childhood when you were born with tremendous joy. Do a meditation, go back to your childhood and see, add joy to the childhood. Add joy to the time you were born. Then you've changed time. Because joy is absolute, you can even change your astrology with that a little bit. You won't change it completely, but by doing a rebirthing process, remember joy and love are absolute. Time, space, everything is relative. You can actually modify your life. You know? So by staying more in joy, you're changing your astrology because you're changing everything. You're changing time, space, everything. Not so much, slightly. Even in relativity, you cannot feel those effects in common day events. You only feel them when you're moving at some fractional speed of light. Nobody's moving at that fractional speed of light on Earth. So you know the differences are very, very small, right? So it depends how much joy you add in your life. If you add a lot of joy, then you can change your life. Your the time of your birth doesn't matter. You know, you're not locked in that, okay, this is my path and this is what it will be. Because know that joy and love are even bigger than anything, bigger than the constraints of time, bigger than the time of your birth, anything. So there's, you know, you have to recognize these energies of joy and love and other soul feelings. Or you can even call, as I said, call them energies also. These soul energies, soul feelings, these are infinite and they're absolute, and you know, especially the primordial ones, you know. And then slowly you get many soul feelings, but you know, not all of them are in the same in your, you know, everything starts with primordial joy, then love, then compassion is there, then you have abundance and gratitude and, you know, forgiveness and peace and freedom. And so all of these are words we use to understand the same thing. But it is so multidimensional that we have to give different words. Deep down, love is joy. Joy is love. Joy is laughter. Laughter is creativity. Deep down, oh, there is a oneness in all of this. But we are communicating using the mind, and we are still living in human existence. So to us, they seem a bit different flavors, you know. But there is that oneness, you know, in all of these. So this is the topic. That's why I spent a little time on love and joy. How do you create this strength? You know, so now instead of staying a little bit abstract, let's move to some real world stories and, you know, like how facing adversity, some of the role models we've seen in our history, some of the incarnation of the goddesses and gods, how they invoked this joy and this love and how they changed their lives. So one historical figure that comes to my mind, which maybe will come in the next book, I didn't ask any questions about her, so obviously there were no answers. So there's some rules in the spiritual realms. You get answers to what you ask. There's no free advice given, you know. If you don't ask something, you don't get the advice. So you have to make the effort. We have to ask. If you ask, it is given. If you don't ask, you know, there is only humans give free advice, you know. You have a problem and there are 100 people, they want to advise you how to solve it. Even if you don't ask, you just talk about the problem and you're not looking for a solution and everybody will tell you how to solve it. But that's not how it works with divine beings. You have to specifically ask. So I did not ask about one historical figure we know of, and let us begin our discussion with her today, because she came in our meditations recently, and her name is Mirabai. Have you heard of Mirabai, all of you? Yeah. So let's talk about her and how she changed her life with love and joy, and how that became her source of strength. And that's the divine feminine way. Okay. So the image we received about Mirabai that I meditated in recently was, you know, she is completely dancing in joy, you know, wherever she is, you know, ecstasy, she's in that. And that's the image she showed. And, you know, so then I did some, you know, I looked at some Mirabai's history and some of that, you know, and it's very interesting what Mirabai's story is. So she was born in a village in Rajasthan named Kurki. Yeah. And this is the same village my mother was born. And it's a village close to Pushkar, where I was born. And she was born there, but I think that must have been her mother's side of family, because they used to come to the mothers to give birth. And then she was raised in a town called Mertha in Rajasthan. And she was a daughter of these Rajputs. They were the royal families, the Rathors, you know, the royal family in Rajasthan. And she was born to, her father's name was Ratan Singh. She was born there and she was growing up, royal family. So as she was growing up, she just had this natural inclination for Krishna right from the beginning. So it was a house that was a Vaishnav house. They used to have, you know, the Vaishnav path, the Hindu gods and goddesses, and they used to worship Durga. Actually, Durga was also, this house, I'm not sure, but Durga was in her in-laws' house later. But this was also a Vaishnav house where she grew up. So there were images of Krishna, there was idols of Krishna. She was growing up and the story goes that you probably all have read, that one day there was this procession going on. You know how weddings happen in India. So there is this bridegroom on the horse and he's all decorated, wearing his sherwani and, you know, his, you know, ornaments. And there is this, you know, very looking very princely and on the horse. And Meera is like a 10-year-old watching this. And now she has the intelligence because she's a 10-year-old. So as she's watching this, she somehow gets fascinated by the bridegroom, you know, looking at him. You know. So she just looks at her mother and she just asks something like, who is my bridegroom, you know? And a 10-year-old asking, because she doesn't know anything about what is this, but she was fascinated by this bridegroom on the horse. So she just says, who is my, you know, bridegroom, you know? And the mother doesn't know what to say, you know, what kind of question from a 10-year-old. So there's a statue of Krishna, a little statue. And she just points to that and she says, Krishna, he's your bridegroom. And she already was inclined to that, you know, as she was growing up in the house, she felt close to Krishna energy. So she immediately takes on to that energy. Immediately. And now the whole world changes. Something happens to her. So she is taking care of that statue, little idol of Krishna. She's bathing it. She's putting clothes on it. She is talking to it. She's dancing around it. She is even putting the statue close to her in the bed when she's sleeping. Her whole life changes. You know, it all becomes about Krishna. Now, some of this comes from our soul inclination. So this was the immediate thought when I thought about Meera, that she most likely, and I felt this very strongly in my body, that's how we channel. So I'd never heard this, but I felt in my body most strongly that, and then this is a message coming, that she's a incarnation of Radha, of Lakshmi. And then I researched it, and that's what everybody's saying. You know, I mean, that is how people have understood her. If you research her, that she's incarnation of Radha. So same stream of Lakshmi coming like that. But even people who don't know this, if you were to reflect on her life, this thought will come from your divine beings that she's Radha. Same thing, you'll just feel it. And so we know about the love of Radha and Krishna. So as she's growing up, she came in this life, this period of 16th century, was also the time when Tulsidas was born. This was a very special period. There are periods which are special. So in this period, Meera also comes. And Tulsidas was the incarnation of Valmiki. He came to add love and joy in Ramayana. So he wrote Ramcharitmanas. There are differences. The differences are that the seventh part of Ramayana, which was added on by the male priest after Valmiki, which is what the research says, Indian government says, which is also what Lakshmiji says, it was all added up. That part is not there in Ramcharitmanas. All the stories of, you know, Sita being removed from her palace, from her house, and taken by Lakshman, all that, if you look at Ramcharitmanas, that doesn't exist. He was connected. Tulsidas was connected. All he used to get visions of Hanuman, Lakshmiji. He lived long. There was not a reason that he wouldn't have put the seventh part. The only reason was it was not true. And he was incarnation of Valmiki. So he did not put it because he wanted to correct Ramayana. Of course, those were political times. So he didn't want to make a big deal about it. He didn't want to announce that Valmiki's Ramayana that you read is wrong. Mine is right. He didn't want to create that kind of contention. He simply left it out. The seventh part just doesn't exist. So it's a very special time. Valmiki was born as, you know, Tulsidas, and Radha was born as Meera at that time. So she's growing up and she is in love with Krishna. Krishna becomes everything for her. You know, she's growing up, she's 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, you know. There is also the time where girls become romantic, you know. So he was also the one who she took on as her husband. So he became everything for her. Her husband, her the one whom she took care of, her God, her divine being. It was all Krishna for her. And she was Radha, so obviously it makes sense, you know. And she wrote some of the most beautiful poetry. Today they say either these were originally hers or inspired by her. After she passed away, the whole India was aflame with, you know, like at least North India and even South India, it went with the effect she had. You know, she was like the first true divine feminist. You know, there's a little bit of that feminist, divine feminist, I would call it, because she went against almost everything at the time. Family conventions, social conventions, every conventions, you know, complete freedom, you know, like she did what she did. So Meera, as she devoted herself to this energy of Krishna, it transformed her. You know, she was, of course, Lakshmi's incarnation, Radha's incarnation. So obviously she's been enlightened before. So even in this life, she will get that kind of enlightenment. So as she surrendered in complete devotion, her chakras opened more and more. And her poetry reflects that, you know, like her poetry is magnanimous, you know, it's like, there are things like, you know, mountains are my shoulders, my body is like the earth, you know, the whole, the sky is who I am, you know, the way the poetry goes, you know, you can feel that she's become something more than just a human being, you know. And then there's this deep longing for Krishna in the poetry of the invisible and, you know, and, you know, beautiful, you know, and that inspired many more. After even she passed away, she probably inspired those people who had connected with Meera. She's probably coming in her dreams and giving more poetry. So that led to more poetry. And now they say there are like, you know, thousands and tens of thousands of bhajans, which are sung in India, you know, inspired by her. Lots of bhajans. And it all came from that source. So why did that source become so big, so important? She was a human being, you know. She just lived 400 years ago. We're not talking about 2000 years ago. She's a recent incarnation, right? So what happened? So let's continue with the story. She turns 18. And when she turns 18, she is married. And she is married to somebody who is a prince. Bhoj Raj, his name is. And he's the son of Rana Sangha. Rana Sangha is the one who's famous for having fought Babur many times. And many times he defeated Babur's armies. But then he was betrayed by one of the, you know, they made a coalition of all the Rajputs and they fought Babur and they would have won. But there was a betrayal by one of the kings or generals. And that betrayal led to Babur defeating them. So what happened then when she married Bhoj Raj? What happened? He was both impressed, Bhoj Raj, and both like got afraid and got into a little bit of fear. Like, who is this woman I've married, you know? She doesn't seem to love me as much as Krishna. And she's completely devoted to Krishna. And he kind of was intrigued by that, you know, like, what is this, you know, like complete devotion. But, you know, there are many versions of these stories in the scriptures, you know, what really happened. Some are added, some are contradictory, what happened, what didn't happen. But certain things are clear, that she was totally devoted to Krishna, that after her marriage, she did her duties dutifully, whatever was required. And then she would go to the temples. And she was fond of all temples associated with Krishna, which she did all of her life. Excuse me. So she would go to the temple in Chittor, where the palace was, and there was a temple. And later on, it seems they even her temple was even built in the palace later. But she would go to the temples and she would go into that ecstasy because that is what she was, you know. She remembered her life as Radha and she would dance with Krishna. So in these temples, she would dance in public. Now, India and the Rajasthan of India was, you know, maybe a little different, but it was kind of what it is even 50 years ago, what I grew up with in Pushkar. I saw a lot of that tradition and, you know, how women were raised and how, you know, they had to, the women, it was patriarchy by then, you know, because Babur had already ruled for some time and they would take away the Hindu women. And so whatever they used to do, this parda and all that came with Babur because they had to protect their women. So all that had spread already. So women's role was not that independent that you could just go in a temple and start dancing, right? But she would do that. And as she would do that, the word came back to the family that she goes, and he was a crown prince, Bhoj Raj, and she is his wife, and she goes and dances in temple. They didn't like it, obviously. But she was in her joy and ecstasy, and they didn't like it. Now, this is where the challenge comes. What do you do? Do you stop doing that? Do you surrender to your family and, you know, stop expressing your love for Krishna? She was the divine feminist. She chose, no, my love for Krishna is real. So she continued that. So the misunderstanding increased between her and the family. They could not understand her. She could not understand them. And they were worshippers of Durga, her in-laws, and they wanted her to surrender to that energy. She said, for me, everything is Krishna. Not that even Durga is amazing, but you know, she had a path. You know, you can have a path. And her path as Radha was Krishna. So she totally surrendered to Krishna. They didn't know what to make of it for a while, but then they started having problems, you know. This is not good, you know. She is giving a bad name to the family. She dances in public and this and that. So then the in-laws tried to do certain things. The stories go, you know. They sent her, you know, a glass of poison and she just took Krishna's name and she drank it and it became nectar for her. By then her chakras had opened enough that, you know, she had these spiritual powers. They sent a basket of flowers, but in that basket of flowers, they didn't put the flowers. They put a cobra snake. But when she opened the basket, she found a Krishna's idol and a garland. So these things would happen and she just wouldn't die. You know, they were trying to kill her. But who ends up dying is her husband in the war with Emperor Babur. 3 years after she got married, the husband died. So husband died, now she's a Rajput woman. Many Rajput women, especially the from royalty, would become sati, would go on the pyre and, you know, light themselves up. She refused to do that. She said, my path is with Krishna, and Krishna would give her guidance. So she did not do that. Then she kept living like this with these misunderstandings with the family. Someone named Vikram Singh became the new king. And, you know, both her father-in-law and her husband died. But still, there were these problems. So due to that, then she decided that maybe I need to leave this place and go back to where I grew up, you know. So she went back to Kurki, but her parents didn't accept her. It was kind of like it is 100 years ago, 400 years ago was not so different. Parents were also like, you know, now you are your in-laws and, you know, so we don't want to deal with this. So then she asked Krishna, you know, what should I do? And she was told, go to Vrindavan. So she walked from Rajasthan in the, you know, heat, and she went all the way to Vrindavan. And as she's going to Vrindavan, somehow because of her energy, the word spread. So she already had a following by then because she used to do these dances and she was in total ecstasy. When you see that on somebody's face, you recognize that they are a great saint. Especially Indians are very connected to that energy in India. You know, they were not that scientific. They were more of heart people. So when they saw somebody who's totally lit like that, you know, dances like a goddess, they know this is it. You know, we got to follow this person. So there were many like that. And so they followed her. And so by the time she reached Vrindavan, you know, people knew who she is and, you know, and she would continue that, you know, go to temples and dance. But there she goes to Vrindavan. Now there's a power structure, again, a patriarchy. There are these mutts and then there are these, you know, big priests who are supposed to, you know, run the temples. And one of them tells them that, you know, we don't allow women here like this. So she talks to him and she says, you know, you think you are the man here? She looks at him and she says, you know, there's only one man here. The only Purusha here is Krishna. You're in love with Krishna. I'm in love with Krishna. So we're all women. You're also a woman. I'm also a woman. We're all women because we're all in love with Krishna deep down. There's only one man here. So she says that and this Pandit priest, you know, he just surrenders to that energy and he says, okay, okay. But so she lives in Vrindavan for a few years and has a good influence there. And then the story goes, after that, when the time comes, she gets older, she goes to Dwarka. And then there she has a very interesting end to her life. The legend is that she is looking at Krishna's statue, and when the time comes for her to leave, she just merges with the statue energetically and she's gone. Yeah. Now, there are stories like this about, in Tibet, you'll see stories of, you know, rainbow bodies, and you know how people just leave their bodies and only hair and nails are left, and you know, so love and joy are so deep, so infinite. Joy is like light, joy is fire, joy is the fire element. And as you start adding more and more joy, more and more joy into your life, your body starts changing. That's what they mean by rainbow body in Tibetan. Your physicality starts changing. There's almost a mutation, you know, like the spiritual energy, physical energy starts becoming one. So that can happen. I mean, I'm not, you know, I'm also scientific. I have a, you know, I had a mathematics, my BSc was in mathematics. So, you know, so I have a scientific mind, but I'm open to energies, and energies, it's possible, you know. I mean, we hear about practices in Tibet even now. There's something called tammo, where the monks just breathe. And as they are breathing, they control the energy of the body. And the experiments done by Harvard scientists, you know, in the winter months, they put damp clothes on them, you know, wet clothes on them. And their bodies, you know, they're just, you know, no clothes on their bodies, just this damp clothes in the winter. And just by breathing practices, they can dry up these clothes, you know. Their bodies become so hot. So this is scientifically proven. This is like people have done studies and they've seen these monks do that. So energy, physical energy, spiritual energy, it connects with joy. Joy is an energy. You can transform your body. That is how miracles happen even in PSSM. You just breathe and breathe and your sicknesses are gone. Right? That's what I hear from a lot of you, that, you know, just you go deep into your breath, then you tap into that energy, and then you add some sickness and it disappeared. It can happen. I'm not saying everybody should do that. Maybe there are times to go to a doctor. But if you feel you have that power, then at least try it. You know, it's not going to hurt you. You know, surrender to that joy. So joy is a great source of strength. And it is a source of strength that can make a woman like Meera, in a patriarchal society, which I have seen, because I was born in 1963, you know. So I've seen the women there, how the ghungat and parda and all of that, you know, how the male patriarchy, it was not so different in 1970 as it was, let's say, you know, maybe a little, now it has changed. Now we are in 2020. So even now today, if you go to places like Udaipur, you can find a woman who's completely wearing and parda and, you know, all the water on their head and all that. Even today, you can see these images. You know, all that patriarchy is still living in India. India, some places are stuck in time. You can actually visit those places and they were the same 300 years ago. Also, they've not moved. You know. So you can feel that in some villages, you can feel that. So Meera was from that time. In that time, she danced in ecstasy in temples, with public, and she lived her life, and she wrote poetry and inspired, you know, tens of thousands of bhajans in India. The whole India started singing these songs. You know, even my mother probably grew up with some of these songs. Had such influence on all over India. Just one woman in a patriarchal world just lived her life with her joy, with her love for her Krishna, with her joy for her dance for Krishna. Look what was created. Think about, you know, and this is 16th century. This is not some time from 2000 years ago, you know. This is like recent times, yeah, under Mughals. And how did that happen? So that's the strength of love and joy. So now bringing this back to our lives, how can we do that? How can things happen to us? What do we do? And what did Meera do? I'm sure the husband must have spoken to her, like, what is it? You don't love me. You only have this Krishna. Why did you marry me? And I'm the prince. And all these questions must have happened in normal marriage, right? I'm sure he would have spoken. She could have gotten depressed. A lot of marriages, there are arguments. And the husband tries to dominate and many times. And the wife gets depressed and they don't know what to do. The only differences between that marriage and Meera's marriage is Meera has a source that nourishes her, that love for Krishna and the joy, that love and joy and that respect for one's body also, that my body needs to dance, so I will dance. You know? Not thinking that what does society think? You know, I'm dancing in a temple. My body wants to dance. She would dance even sometimes on the way. She was going to Vrindavan. And there were some towns, there were some people who had heard about her. She would go to those temples also and dance, you know. So she was like a energy field walking, you know. So can we take that lesson in our life? Can we stay in joy? Even when the husband is, dominating and all that. Just, you know, there's a fly comes and you ignore the fly and you start keep eating your food, you know, you don't get bothered by it, you know. But why do we make these events which happen around us such big events? You know, maybe it's like a fly. You know? Okay, he said that to me, ignore it. Now I go back to my joy. I go back to my practice and I go back to my love. Whatever you love, you know, you might love God, you might love the environment, you might love your child. Love is love, right? So I will live in love, you know. So somebody shouted at me. Let them shout. It didn't affect me, you know. They didn't beat me up. Okay, they just shouted. So let them shout. I will go back to my joy. Can we have that kind of that passion to live? Surrendering to joy and love as much as we can. Because as you do that, it will transform them. Even her husband was transformed somewhat. He was very intrigued by her. They tried to do all the bad things they did, the in-laws did and all of that. But he was also intrigued by her, you know. That was a very different time. More likely than not, if today you surrender to love and joy, your husband or your in-law, whatever, they'll also surrender to love and joy. They'll watch, they'll see you like a goddess. There is enough awakening today that they will surrender. It won't be so bad as it was back then. Because she was a princess with expectations, you know, she could not go to a public temple and this and that. Today, if you are reflecting that love and joy, people will be happy. You know, the arguments will disappear, maybe not completely, but it's easier today. Because today there is we have more democracy, a different world and all that. Main message is how important it is to do things from the place of joy. Whether you dance from joy, whether you love your child from joy, you know, whether you, and how important it is to love, you know. So don't let the world stop you from being love and being joy, you know, don't let that happen to your life. That is an invisible source you have and you have to keep it. That source is not controlled by physicality, by body, by, you know, mind. And even by body, it's not, it is joy is there. You know? And body is also a great source of joy. Eating healthy, taking care of your body, and dancing, yoga, you know, we have many processes that soon, I mean, right now we have this group, Devi Circle, some of you might be on it, you know, I created it, and there's another group, Devi Circle World, right? I can see some hands, Anuradha is on it. So I'll soon start mentioning some of the work we will start. We're starting something called Devi Circle. And this Devi Circle is kind of inspired by these energies only, Meera energy, Radha energy, these energies, you know, like this kind of a divine feminism, which is surrendering to joy and love, which includes masculine because it is love. If the man shouts at you, you become go more into the joy and love. You know, that joy, love, laughter, that's how you control it, you know. You go together with your other women friends and, you know, other, you know, you always stay in that energy. So when you stay in that energy, whatever your situation is, maybe in some places in India, in Maharashtra, there was a story that we used to have this person, housekeeper, who used to come and help. You know, this woman, maid, who would come and help. So one day, she was complaining. And she was saying, my husband does not love me anymore. So my mother and I were like, how do you know he doesn't love you? So she said, he doesn't beat me anymore. Because he doesn't beat me anymore, he doesn't love me. Because he's beating someone else. Now, this is the level of patriarchy in India. This is true. This happens in Maharashtra. It used to happen in Maharashtra. I don't know whether it is true now. So the way she would understand that he doesn't love me is because he's no longer beating me. He's beating another woman. Now, even in that situation, if she could awaken her joy for life and love for life, she could create more boundaries. Because that joy is fire. That energy will start stopping him from beating her, you know, when he will see that energy in her. And she'll have some more sources to stop him. She'll find some friends. Maybe she'll book a complaint. Maybe she'll do something to stop it. But if she goes in depression, if she goes into fear, then she'll let it happen more and more. So there's no point of being in fear. Even in a bad situation, when somebody's beating you, if you remain in fear, then that'll keep happening more and more. What's the point of remaining in fear? So you have to come back to joy, love, your inner strength, to start putting some restrictions also, boundaries also. Hey, you're not going to mess with me. That's how Meera was able to say, I'm not going to become a sati. Because she had that love and joy for Krishna, and she didn't see any point in just burning herself up with her husband when she was with Krishna. There was no point in doing that. You know, even some people might think that there's some value in that, valor in that. But she didn't see any point in that. She didn't do it. That is her freedom. And you'll get that freedom in your heart, in your body, in your life more if you will start living more with joy, more with love. And as you do that, the true strength starts coming. So this is, you know, one story. Now, similarly, there are many other stories, but I've just gone on talking. So let me see if anybody has any questions, and then we'll talk about some other stories of other women who through joy and love have changed their life, you know. Not only changed their life, they changed the whole country, you know. I mean, look at Meera's influence on the whole of India, you know. Just one woman living her life with joy and love recently, you know, just changes the whole culture in a nation. He's known as like one of the biggest poets, saints of India. That's the strength of love and joy. So are there any, I mean, I'll open it up and then we will maybe weave some more stories with, if there are any questions people have.
Hello. Yeah, this is Suresh Babu. Great pranams to Anand Purushji. Today is a great day in the history of Pyramid Spiritual Society movement. We have your presence at our Mahila Jayama Chakra during December 19th. I could able to meet you and the trustee of the Pyramid Spiritual Trust. You enlightened our Pyramid Masters in a huge way during those 10 days. Today is another golden day in the to be written the history. But you know, now you are given a beautiful lecture and a beautiful story on love and joy is the infinite. But you are given a very detailed and story about Meerabai. It's very enlightened us. I read this your great book, Thousand Seeds of Joy. I have a very small doubt. You can throw some light. Sure. Yeah. Here, a great statement given by Saraswati Ji that the emptiness is the infinite presence, yep. Where because it has no center and boundaries. In a detailed way, message was given, but still, it we can throw some light on the statement, our Pendu Masters will be awaiting for your great.
That's a very good question. Thank you. Thank you, Sureshi. That's a very good question. And I would love to talk about that. You know, that's a good question. That's one of the statements in the book.
Yes.
Emptiness is infinite presence.
Yeah.
Okay. It has no center, because it has no center and no boundaries. Right?
Yes. Yeah.
So let's understand the statement deeply, like what is being said. Okay. In some different contexts, even in Meera's context. Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
So what do we mean when we say something as a center or something as boundaries? First, you have to notice that these two reflect each other. Okay. Only when you have a center, so your center is relative to the boundary and boundaries relative to the center.
Yeah. Okay.
Only things that have boundaries will have a center. Only things that have a center will have a boundary, you know. So that itself is relative to each other, you know. That is the finiteness of the world, always as a center, always as boundaries. When we are, when you're truly infinite, when you're truly, truly infinite, then there is no end anywhere in sight.
Yes.
Then there cannot be any center also. How can there be a center of something that is infinite? How can that be? Because center implies that you have equal distance in all directions, right?
Exactly.
No concept of equality. This just goes on forever. Everything is just completely infinite. So with infinity, there cannot be center. There cannot be any boundaries. There cannot be any of that. Now, when we say emptiness is infinite presence, what do we mean by that? This is the, that other part was a little bit just more technical, but this part is very deep. That emptiness is infinite presence. When you empty yourself, and by when we say emptying yourself, what do we mean? We mean we're emptying this mind that we have, you know, we're emptying that.
Yes.
As we're emptying the mind, what happens is we start becoming aware of what really is happening, what this whole energy space is, because it is a mind that has limited you to feeling like you're just this body.
Yes.
Just very limited. It is a mind's, you know, and it is very deep. It is, you know, it is a whole process of birthing and, you know, keeping that mind at a very cellular level alive, you know. If you can completely dissolve the mind, as they say, in even in quantum physics, you know, like if there is no observer, then, you know, the observation is created by the observer, you know, it is influenced by it, you know. But if you just remove that mind, that observer, completely, there's an explosion.
Yeah.
And you suddenly realize you're not limited to just this body. Everything has become you. This bed is me, this wall is me, everything is me. Sky is me, earth is me, everything is me.
Yes.
And it's not even a feeling of me, it is more a feeling of amness. From I-ness, you go to am-ness. From am-ness, you go to is-ness. It's always this whole idea of I just disappears. Everything just becomes is-ness, you know. And you energetically just become one with everything. So that's the meaning of emptiness, dissolving that I-ness, that ego place, you know. As that starts dissolving a little bit, you start feeling, you become more empathetic. You start feeling more energies. Even there are like, you know, minor enlightenments, you know, you'll feel that oneness with trees and so on, you know. But as that dissolves more and more and more, you start becoming that energy field that is infinite, which is everything and nothing, which is beyond these concepts of I, you know, and you. So I am talking to me right now. I am Suresh Ji. And that is literally what's happening, because if you think about it, where is the you? When I say you, where is that you? In your consciousness, you're not experiencing yourself as you, are you? No. You're also experiencing yourself as I. As intimate an I as I experience myself as an I. Everybody here is experiencing themselves as an I, right?
Yeah.
All the animals, trees, they're also experiencing themselves as, you know, that I. I think of you as a you, that's just a figment of imagination. That is not what is happening in front of me, that I'm the person I'm talking to. What is happening is an I, you know. An I isn't talking to an I, you know. And that's a singular I. We think it is a divided I. No, it's not a divided I. It's a singular I. We're all feeling that it's the same I between in all of us.
Yeah. Yes.
But the mind makes it feel it's a I and you. You have a different I. No, no. It's a singular I. It's the same energy. Singular I in Lakshmi ji, Saraswati ji, you, me, Krishna. Everything is in that same I, same source energy. So as you surrender more deeply to that, the mind stops. Mind needs this I and you for the ego to be alive, you know.
Yes.
To be different, you know. I am me, you are you, you know. So then the mind goes on, you know. If I say all of us are I, I'm talking to me, you're also me, you're also me. Just, you know, just for a minute, just think like that. Just we're all me. It's only one I, you know, that we're all talking to. Then you'll notice that the mind slows down. Mind doesn't have a place to go anymore. Because there is all the questions start, stop, they stop.
Yeah.
Talking to me. The questions are, you know, less now, you know, mind is slowed down. And it feels a bit uncomfortable. Why? Because the mind is used to living in the ego space. So they don't like it. Mind doesn't like this kind of idea that all, that you're all, I'm talking to I. Mind doesn't like that.
Yeah, ego.
If that is true, then I can't think anymore, you know, like the way I used to think. Right?
Yes. Yes.
So this is all a process of becoming that emptiness. All of these are ways, this visualization that all of it is me, will empty you more. Because anytime you have less of an ego, there'll be more emptiness. And sometimes it is uncomfortable initially, but this is where our breath and body comes in. If it is uncomfortable, then start feeling your breath.
Practice. You know,
from the body, just keep practicing.
Yes.
And then that will slow calm you down more. And then start feeling people, you know, when you talk to somebody, experience them as the I, you know. There's a person with an I-ness talking to you.
Yes.
Listen to them completely as they are talking, you know. It's not a you, it's an I energy talking to you. Be fully present, you know. Let them be fully present. Don't have your mind going on. Just take a few deep breaths, become empty. And let their I-ness speak. And completely surrender to that energy. You know, what is happening? We're not saying you do what they say, but completely listen, you know, be completely, fully present to that energy. Then you will have know what we call empathy. Yes. Oh, that's how they really feel themselves, you know, because and reflect a little bit on their life, their childhood, what could have been their past life and their childhood and where they're at. Then you'll have a deeper understanding. Like, you know, Donald Trump. Let's try to understand him as this I, you know. He's also I.
Yeah.
It is me. Me is Donald Trump. The part of me talking like this, you know. So what could have happened that is making me behave like that, you know? A part of me, which is Donald Trump, is behaving like he's behaving, you know. What is that? What is happening, you know? What was my childhood like as Donald Trump? That patriarchy of my father, you know, that ambition, you know, that, you know, raising the child with complete lack of emotion, you know, what that did to my mind, how I grew up. I became so fascinated by money only and superficiality, and I always had to win because my father wouldn't love me otherwise, you know. And that little child, you know, suffering child, you know, like wanting love from the father. And father not loving the child unless the child was successful in a very brutal way. He always had to win, always had to win. And growing up like that, I as Donald Trump growing up like that. You know. And then, you know, my father doing all kinds of things with the women around and, you know, growing up. And then maybe my past lives had some karma like that, you know. Maybe I was somebody who wanted to be a king, could not ever be a king. So that idea of winning became so important in my life. I had to win at all cost. Even if people died, I didn't care. So karma, that is a part of me. No. We all have been kings like this in our some lives. Even Valmiki was, you know, somebody who had a past, you know, then he surrendered, you know, and then he, you know, so we all have a past, you know. Angulima, yeah. He had a past like that, you know, he killed 9 yes. people. So yes. all of that is me. Yeah. Donald Trump is also me. I am also me, you know. So if you think of him like that, you will get some understanding about where he is. And then with that understanding, if people had that understanding around him and they spoke to him with that joy, they could change him. But those people are in too much fear. The people who are around him, they're in too much fear. And they go with him with the fear energy. His advisors, you know, they want him to behave differently, but they don't know how to approach him. They either get in fear or they get in anger. But stay in your joy, you know. And with that joy, reach out to him and you will change him a little bit. And him is only me only. I'm changing me only, you know. Like, think of it like that. You know? So you got to deeply, deeply surrender into this I energy. Then you have a bigger effect on the world. Because you stay in your joy and you see a part of me struggling. You try to help that part of you only. You know? You are a part of me who's struggling. You might be Donald Trump. You might be my wife. You might be my husband. Whoever you're struggling, you are me only. But I stay in my joy, and from that joy, I listen to you with this emptiness which does not have mind, which is completely present to you and is in joy, and I see you, and I completely see you, your suffering, then I reach out to you. I reach out with a lot of love to a part of me that is struggling. There's a lot of forgiveness in that, because you are me.
Yes.
You are me, how can I not have forgiveness, you know? You are part of me that is a bit lost, you know. So yeah. I forgive you. I send love to you. I have joy for you. And then you, from that emptiness, that oneness starts happening and you start transforming more. So emptiness is, this emptiness is infinite presence. It has so many ways can be explored forever. This is just some ways.
Yes.
But there are many ways of dissolving the mind.
Yeah.
And as you dissolve the mind more and more, you become more and more energy. And breath helps, techniques help because of that. Doing yoga.
Sure.
Breath work, doing, you know, these techniques are ways to go deep in the body. And body, soul, and higher self are the way to become the emptiness. Because that is where the mind will dissolve in the body, mind will dissolve in the soul. Mind will also dissolve just by remembering Krishna. Devotion path is easy many times, but it requires an advanced seeker.
Yes.
That faith of a Meera, complete.
Total surrenderness.
That I drink this, is Amrit for me.
100%. Yes.
We have that, it becomes Amrit, because energy is energy. It will transform.
Yeah, not even an icon of the doubt.
Yeah, no, not even a percent. Even if you have a 1% of doubt, it won't work.
Yes.
That's why if you walk on water with 1% of doubt, that you'll drown, you will fall inside. But a Jesus can walk on water because he has 100% faith. And this is in a way scientific in this way. See, science does not admit the role of belief on reality. But we know from medicine, belief changes reality. There are studies on placebos. If you believe a medicine will cure you, they found in studies 40% of the people get cured just by that belief. It's a placebo.
Yes.
Very well known.
Yeah.
So belief does affect reality. Now, if you take that logic a little bit further and you say, my belief is total. My faith is 1,000%, you know, like you really meditate, surrender, like, you know, it takes work. But if you have that level of faith, then you're moving energy, you're changing energy. And it can be very scientific that, you know, you change energy, that you become a rainbow body. You can, you know, you can do miracles, you can do whatever. Because in the energy world, everything shifts, you know. So that emptiness becomes infinite presence as you go on dissolving the ego, dissolving the mind, dissolving the
mind.
It has to be done in a skillful way. You cannot throw your ego out. You have to do with a lot of love. Even your own self, you have to see from a third point of view, you know, that you are the infinite being watching this little ego. Because you really are the infinite being, that who you truly are. This ego is just a pretending to be who you are. So watch your ego from that space also, from that space of love. Hold your ego. The ego is just trying to protect you. And then as you love your ego a little bit, the ego will dissolve.
Yes.
Ego will surrender. Okay, there's only love and joy, so why do I need to be here? The ego. Yeah. But if you fight with your ego, don't do that. If you fight with your ego, ego will certainly come.
You have to accept it immediately.
You have to accept your shadow. Your ego. You completely go with love, joy. You know. So in the end, it again comes back to joy and love. You know. So even your ego. So deeply, this emptiness is not emptiness like how we understand like lack. This emptiness is emptiness of the mind. And this emptiness is complete fullness. Remember your childhood when you had those magical moments.
Yes.
That, you know, that we remember those magical moments, you know, where sometimes we are reminded of them and we get tears in our eyes. Oh, I used to feel like this when I was a child.
Yes.
Complete connection, you know. That is emptiness because there was no mind in that. So that emptiness is amazing fullness, a fullness we've forgotten.
The
fullness that we need to know as children. Because vacation used to be long. 3 months vacation, 2 months vacation used to feel like, oh my God, yeah, there's so much time. If you live every day, like the whole day used to go, it used to feel so.
Right?
What happened there? Nowadays, Christmas comes, next Christmas comes, you know, one Diwali comes, next Diwali comes. Because we're in our head, we're not living.
Yes.
Thinking too much, and so we don't feel the space of the time. You know, we don't feel a whole day go by. You know, so that emptiness will create fullness. You know? Empty out, and that is why practices are needed. That is why we do or we do yoga. Even with yoga, you can feel that energy happening. So in the end, you know, use your body, soul, mind to create the emptiness. So your body, soul, higher self. To dissolve your mind and create the emptiness, and you'll become more and more infinite presence, step by step.
Practice makes man perfect. So the more you do practice, you're nearer to making your mind empty.
Yeah.
That is the whole underlining here.
Thank you very much. Because the question is so big, but I didn't
want to. Of course. I know. But even then, you are given a very detailed explanation. It's very... understandable and very enlightened. Thank you very much, sir.
Welcome. Yeah. Maybe we'll talk about some other women.
Mahila energy is going on, sir. Yeah. We have to give importance to Mahila.
Strength with love and joy. You know, men also.
Exactly.
There are some.
Yes, sir. We have to give top priority to our women.
Or the feminine within us.
Feminine energy, yes. Yeah.
Not women, but the feminine part of all human beings that has been subdued has to rise up. And the love, joy are fire and water energies. And so Lakshmiji says fire, water is feminine. Earth and air are masculine. Earth is physicality, air is the mind energy. And fire is joy energy and water is love energy. So we're talking about love and joy. We're talking about fire, water. And that's So there was you obviously know about Radha's life, but Radha also in our book, the way Lakshmiji talks about Radha is in a little bit of a different way. In fact, Radha is a little bit older. Lakshmi says I was a little bit older when I would meet Krishna. But we've created this idea that she was a teenager, but no, she was a little bit older. And she was more like a crone energy. So she was, she said she didn't want to marry Krishna. Because she was very independent. There's another feminist over here with Radha. She would visit him and they had a very good friendship. So Krishna had, you know, Lakshmiji's three incarnations were with Krishna in that life. So Radha was his friend as a crone. Crone energy is very wise energy. Rukmani was the maiden, the mother matron energy, which was Lakshmi's incarnation, who was Krishna's wife. And then Draupadi was the maiden energy. The maiden is like the younger energy, you know. So you have maiden, matron, crone. So Lakshmiji came as all three to be with Krishna, who's Vishnu, in that life, right? So as Radha, she was very independent and very enlightened.
Yes.
And she would, you know, she was independent. She had her own place where she lived. She also had some kind of a retreat set up in some place in mountains that Lakshmiji talks about. And then it was kind of steep to get there. She said like horses could not climb there, the book says, you know. And she would stay in these higher places of energies to connect with the divinity, to connect with Krishna's energy, because Krishna was very busy, she says. She describes in some detail how Krishna was in the book.
Yeah.
You know, like he would speak a little bit faster, she would say. And then he would take care of family a lot, and everybody was family for him, you know. Loved everybody, and he was doing so many things. He was running a kingdom, he's helping Pandavas, he's meditating, he's present for the population like a true benevolent king all the time. He was very, very busy. So she talks about him, but their love was very divine, very special. They would come together, they would even dance together, you know. And she talks a little bit about that, you know. So there was a little bit of intimacy, but it was not intimacy at all in the way the world has explained it, you know. It was sensualness, but there was not sexuality to it. So there was a complete sensual connection, a dancing, talking, loving in that way, you know. And there was so much joy in that energy that both of them were so enlightened that they didn't have to come together like two human beings. Just by holding hands or, dancing together would get them in that ecstasy, you know, because they were so, both of them were so enlightened, you know. And when you're that enlightened, all your chakras are open. And all your chakras are open, you don't need an outer union, you know. It's happening inward. You're already in that union, you know. And that is the meaning of Tantra also, you know. It is all within one's body. One can experience that just by holding somebody's hand, you know, because you're so spiritually together, your souls are one, you know. So this was, Radha was like a complete manifestation of that enlightened energy. You know, Radha is not even mentioned in the older scriptures. She was revealed later. She came around 1000 AD, she starts being mentioned in our scriptures, you know. Because then she came, she showed herself with some of these, you know, meditators, saints, meditating, channeling. Then they wrote about Radha. But Radha's mention is not there in Mahabharata, you know, if you go back to the old scriptures. Because this was the invisible, she was invisible to the world, you know. She was like, you know, living in these places and she would meet Krishna. But, you know, Krishna would meet many people. We don't know everybody who he met, right? Because he was such a profound energy. So this Radha's connection was revealed later when the bhakti movement started, you know. And then Meera was Radha's incarnation. And then Meera's objective was, you know, even Radha, however she was revealed, what we think of Radha, oh, she missed Krishna so much. And then some stories are she committed suicide, this, that, you know, nothing like that happened. She was independent. She didn't want to marry Krishna. They were like, you know, they would come together for spiritual communion. They would talk to each other. Lakshmiji says that I would be like a battery to him. So then I asked in the book, you know, what do you mean by you would be like a battery to him? You know, wasn't he already full? Why would he need to be energized by you? So she said, well, I was not the only one who energized him. Even other things energized him. You know, even taking care of the people get his energy all filled up, you know, like, you know, so he would be resting. And then he would be so alive. So when he would be alive, he would be taking care of people. He would be with Radha, or he would be doing those things, you know. So again, the connection is about that profound primordial joy and love that happens with spiritual practice. With Radha's story, we learn that that is not divided from what we think of as love, you know. It is all, in Tantra, everything comes together. The physical, she says, my love was Vajra love, which is all physical, mental, spiritual, all together. It is just one love. And we don't define it as, you know, this kind of love, that kind of love. You know, it is a bhakti love. That is the same Meera's love. Meera is, Krishna is also husband to Meera, you know. So it's just this one love, complete love, you know, which is you become one. And that love, joy, becoming totally one is their story. So the last story I want to briefly mention, which I've mentioned once, is about Saraswati. Again, coming in a challenging circumstance, and then again surrendering to love and joy and a life that affects, you know, millions of human beings. So this is a life where I've spoken once, I think, in one talk, where there are, you know, do you know who's the Krishna of Buddhism? There's a Krishna-like figure in Buddhism. Who's that? That is not Gautama Buddha. Gautama Buddha was Buddha, but there's a Krishna-type Buddha in Buddhism. Anybody knows that? He is, his name is Padmasambhava. He's also called Guru Rinpoche. And whole of Tibet is about Padmasambhava energy. Even Bhutan, there is this place which is dedicated to Padmasambhava. So Padmasambhava, you know, his birth was also very, you know, miraculous, like Krishna was born. So, he came kind of enlightened, you know. He got enlightened very quickly. I mean, he was not fully enlightened. His full enlightenment happened with one princess, Mandarva, and he's associated with two women. One is Princess Mandarva, another is Yeshe Syogal. So Yeshe is somebody that he wants to incarnate. He's asking Saraswati in one of the scriptures that when will you incarnate? When will you incarnate? Because his path has begun and he is spreading this knowledge. You know, he's become enlightened with Mandarva. He's in some caves in Nepal. And then he goes to Tibet at the invitation of the emperor of Tibet. His name is Trishon Detsen, is the emperor of Tibet. And that emperor has heard about Padmasambhava. He invites him to Tibet. And by then, Yeshe Syogal has become this emperor's wife by then, you know. So who is Yeshe, you know, who had become the emperor's wife? So Yeshe was Saraswati's incarnation, according to Buddhism. And she was born as a princess in a noble family in Tibet. Princess of Karshen, they call her. And her birth was painless, you know, like, and she was a divine child. She was very, very beautiful. And as she was, you know, she was growing up, the tribal chiefs around there heard about her, her beauty and all of that. You know. So she's not interested in marriage and these things. She's very much into, her chakras are so open. Some of these people, their lower and upper chakras are so combined and so open, or they're opening up so amazingly that they feel such infinite ecstasy in simple things. Just walking in nature, just looking at a mountain. They feel such joy within their body, outside, everything, that, you know, when they see a normal human being, a tribal chief wants to marry them, and they can tell immediately just by looking at them, you know, that they don't have that infinite presence that they're feeling. So they don't want to marry, you know. What's the point of, you know, getting married and then getting into these restrictions? You can't do this. You have to cook for me. You have to do that. You know, all kinds of problems and all of that. You know, she didn't want to marry. So she didn't want to marry, but she had a patriarchal father. So he married her to one of the tribal chiefs. Now she didn't want to go. So then she had to be dragged. They chained her and they took her in. And then she escaped. She escaped from one tribal chief, then the other tribal chief got her. Then, you know, so then she somehow she went through all this torture and all of that. And then somehow the word spread that this beautiful woman, you know, she doesn't want to be married and she is incredibly beautiful. And somehow the emperor heard about her. And then he saved her, then he invited her, and somehow the father decided that she'll get married to the emperor. So even the emperor, she didn't want to get married to, but he was a kind of a spiritual fellow, you know. this guy, Trisong, he was a spiritual type, so he left her alone. You know, you do your practices, you be my wife, but you know, and he allowed her to do her spiritual practices. So she was kind of okay, happy. And then he was spiritual enough to invite Guru Rinpoche, Padmasambhava. And this is where Guru Padmasambhava had been looking for his Saraswati, who would come, and he needed her because she was going to do all kind of scribing, writing of scriptures, which will create Vajrayana Buddhism. And he was so busy talking and, you know, being with people, he didn't have time to write, you know. So he needed, you need that woman, that strength. And even though he was enlightened, he needed that partner, you know, to do his spiritual work. So he had been in some of the poetry, he's been saying, you know, where are you, my Saraswati? When are you coming, you know? And then he goes to visit the emperor and he looks at Yeshe, and they immediately, he knows that she's Saraswati. So they talk, and then the emperor is happy because he's emperor is a spiritual person. So he knows that, okay, this is why I married her, I saved her from those tribal chiefs. And Yeshe feels the same. She gets very affected by his energy, by Padmasambhava. She wants to go with him. So then they go together. And then she becomes his spiritual consort. And, you know, they spend time together. They go in caves. You know, he teaches her. He's enlightened by then. So, and Saraswatiji, Saraswati's incarnation. So she's just waiting to get enlightened. So with Padmasambhava, she gets all the full enlightenments, you know, slowly she gets fully enlightened. And now if you look at her life, what is there in her life? You know, she's being raised up, patriarchal father marries her, but she surrenders to joy and love and freedom. Freedom is, you know, that independence that Meera showed, you know, that when Meera wanted to dance in temples, she danced, you know. So with Yeshe, she didn't want to be with the tribal chief, so she left. So that is the freedom part. Freedom is also a soul feeling, you know. So you have to celebrate freedom also, but not fighting. Freedom doesn't mean that we fight against somebody. She didn't want to destroy the tribal chief. She just wanted her freedom, you know, leave me alone. Let me do my spiritual practices, you know. So you see those divine feminine values that she surrendered to, and she maintained her practice. Her practice is how she was able to overcome these difficulties. If she didn't practice, if she didn't feel that joy and love, she would surrender in fear. She would become the tribal chief's wife. You know, what's the point of fighting this guy? You know, he's going to kill me. So let's just be his wife. A lot of women do that, you know, because they don't have that fire of joy and love, you know. But if you have that fire of joy and love and freedom, then you'll create a path. So she somehow manifested her path, you know, going through these tribal chiefs, coming to the emperor, eventually finding Padmasambhava. And that is became her source of enlightenment, you know. Then they did different kinds of practices, the Tibetan Buddhism, Tantric Buddhism, and through that she got fully enlightened. Then throughout her life, she wrote these scriptures about Padmasambhava, about her own life, many, many scriptures. Some of them, she put her energy into these stones and things that when these enlightened masters would come in the future, they're called treasure revealers or turtons in Buddhism, that in Buddhism, Buddhists are very smart people. So, you know, they knew that a scripture should come only at a certain time. There's a timing to these different scriptures. So if we look at Bible was a scripture, but was not, everything is, of course, has its own timing. But when Bible came, the world was not ready for Bible. The world was not ready for Jesus. You know, when he would talk about those teachings, you know, they put him on the cross. And he was saying simple things about love and joy and all of that, you know, but the world was not ready. So Buddhists understood this, that even Tibet, as good as an empire it is all political in the end, you know. Emperors want the full power because they don't want a saint or somebody to be more powerful. That was a big fight between saints and kings, because saints were so free, they would be like, you know, I don't have any ruler, like even king also, you know, I say things which are what I say, you know. Kings didn't like that, you know, kings wanted everything to be according to them. So they changed the Bible. And they changed the Bible and they made Jesus a much smaller person than Jesus was. Jesus was like Buddha, very enlightened, you know. but they make him very small in the Bible, you know, and that became the Bible. So these turtles and treasure revealers, they will discover what Yeshe has written, but Yeshe did not reveal all of her writings right away. Because if she revealed it, what they would do? They would destroy it. They would create it according to what they think is correct, the kings and all that. You know, there's a timing to this. And these scriptures were hidden sometimes under a lake, sometimes in a stone, sometimes in actual books. And there are actual instances of revelations of scriptures of Yeshe over these centuries, even in the 18th century, 17th century, 16th century, because Yeshe lived sometime in 8th century and 11th, 12th, all these centuries, many of these treasures have been revealed. So she wrote a lot. She's like a true Saraswati writing wisdom. Saraswati, she's really created three important parts. One is Vedanta, you know, where all the stories begin with her. Then Mahayana Buddhism, where she came as Manjushri's wife. Manjushri had two wives, Lakshmiji and Saraswatiji, who was a big Buddha. And then as Padmasambhava's consort as Yeshe. And there she wrote all about Vajrayana Buddhism, Tantric Buddhism, all kinds of practices, DT practice, you know, how to become. They take devotion to a science level, you know, in Buddhism. In Hinduism, we have devotion. In Buddhism also, they have devotion in Vajrayana Buddhism. But it's taken it to another level. You know, how do you, everything is defined. You know, how do you practice? You put a picture in front of you and, you know, you look, you gaze in the eyes and you first become, you know, first you look at them as they are the divine being and you are the worshiper. Then at one point, you become the divine being. There are steps to all of this, you know. And you see yourself as the divine being, you know, and then they describe this in detail in, you know, in Vajrayana Buddhism, how to do devotion. Like Meera did devotion just naturally. She just took care of the idol and she worshipped it and all of that, right? But there's a systematic way to do devotion. And that is what you learn in Vajrayana Buddhism. And she wrote about all of that, many scriptures. So where she's being married off to a tribal chief, and how she becomes a fully enlightened Buddha and creates a whole path in Buddhism called Vajrayana Buddhism. Again, with the same soul feelings, joy for life, you know, love, freedom, and they're pursuing that. So there, you know, the East, including India and Tibet and these places, they're full of these stories of divine feminine. Strong women who rose up with love and joy to create great paths. And the message for us is surrender more to these feelings. You know, don't live in fear, live in love, live in joy, live in freedom. You know, don't surrender your freedom to, you know, some stupid ideologies and all of that, you know, but do it with a lot of love and joy. You can be free with joy and love. There are, you know, ways in relationships, even there are contentions between daughter-in-law, mother-in-law, that these things that happen, right? Now, let's say the mother-in-law says something to the daughter-in-law and, you know, she's the older one and the daughter-in-law doesn't like it. There's some old traditional things mother-in-laws say a lot of times. So there are many ways of dealing with it. One is you get into this energy that she's trying to control me and, you know, I'm free and, you know, like, you know, ignore her. But you don't have to sacrifice love when you have freedom. You can hold your mother-in-law's hand, take her to the, you know, somewhere, sit down with her, keep holding her hand, look in her eyes, get as much love as possible on your, you know, in your heart, and say, I will do it like this because it makes me happy. But keep holding her hand. That body language will communicate to her that you love her, right? And you're still making a statement which is about your freedom, right? So there are ways to communicate where you can, with your body language, make people feel that they are loved, but also let them know that you are free, that you have your own path, you know? that love doesn't have to be divorced from freedom. You want to be who you are, but you will always love them also, right? Can you have all of that together? When you put all of that together, then that becomes divine feminine. Then you are not like a feminist, which is, you know, more about fighting energy. It is about creating a path where you are inclusive, where you are the Devi, you are the goddess, and you are who you are, but you don't exclude people also. People feel your energy, they feel the love, you know. So, and it can happen the other way also. Maybe the mother-in-law is more enlightened than the daughter-in-law, you know. I mean, this is only in the Indian context so much, because there are a lot of families that live together. In the West, they don't live together so much. The mother-in-law could do the same thing too. She can come with a lot of love and freedom also and say, you know, this is how I live, and, you know, and use the soul feelings, use body energy, use, you know, gestures, you know, there's much you can do by in communication where you don't sacrifice love for freedom, or you don't sacrifice freedom for love. This is typically what's happening in relationships. In couples also, there are sometimes for love, you sacrifice your freedom. Other times for your freedom, you sacrifice your love. Why do you have to sacrifice? Have both. Be skillful. Find a way. Create. That is what creativity is all about. Creativity is doing the impossible. Otherwise, there's nothing about creativity. Creativity is, how was iPhone created? It was created because Steve Jobs was shouting at his technicians that I want something that with three clicks will get to a song. And all the other, gadgets by then, you had to go six clicks to get to that final song, you know. So scientists were saying, no, we can't do it, all these technical people. Steve Jobs didn't give up. He said, no, I want it in three clicks only. And then they were creative, they figured it out, and that became iPod. So creativity comes in when you have to find things which are impossible. So a relationship where you feel you cannot have both love and freedom is a place where you need creativity. You need a new way of thinking where you can have tremendous love and tremendous freedom. You can be who you are and you can still have a lot of love. You don't have to be dominated, and at the same time, you can have love. You know, so this is where, you know, as you see, I'm subtly, what I'm doing, I'm adding all the soul feelings together. I'm saying love should be with freedom, but to put them together, you need creativity, which is another soul feeling. So if you start thinking deeply like this, when these soul feelings come together, you can call them soul energies also. When these energies come together, then magic starts happening in life. You know, you don't want to give up one for the other. You know, a lot of women give up, a lot of men give up their love lives because they want freedom. Because they think, you know, the only way I can be free is I don't need love. I'll be independent. You can have both. And one way that Parvatiji is teaching me these days, how to be both, because I'm in the financial world and I'm in the spiritual world. Sometimes in the financial world, the energy is very different and I don't like it, you know. So I ask her, how do I deal with it? So she says, be in the body, she said. I said, I'm in the body. She said, no. When you're in the financial world, sometimes you, with the arguments, you know, people have, you still have to be completely in the body, in the love, in that space, you know. So when you are dealing with these issues of love and freedom, contention, take a deep breath, become the body, feel your body. Then again, start talking, you know. Don't get in the head, you know. If you're having an argument, again, take a deep breath, become the body. Always become the body, because body has more intelligence than your mind. It knows the other person more. Your body is infinite, it is almost infinite intelligence, not infinite. Soul is infinite, but body is so vast compared to the mind, you know. Like feel your stomach, feel your heart, you know, put it like that, and then hold somebody's hand, you know. Use your body in different ways, you know, by breathing, by gestures, and give it that honor and respect that it deserves, and it'll help you. It'll help you become creative. It'll help you find both love and freedom and joy and peace, you know. So that's the message, to create strength using love and joy and other soul feelings. These are invisible things, but you can create tremendous strength. So that's kind of my message. If there are any other questions, we have maybe 10 more minutes. Yeah.
Yeah. From women's side. Yeah. Anuradha?
Yes.
Sir, actually,
continue.
Sir, actually, I don't have any question, but while I'm listening your teachings, now I experiencing that love, joy, surrenderness, and even I'm feeling that energy from your eyes. Class was fantastic. Very, very nice. It was very nice. I'm experiencing love, joy, surrender, sacrifice, everything, sir. Means feminine energy. Anything? Thanks. freedom. Yes, sir. Freedom.
Control your life.
Yes.
The freedom with love and joy, yes. And sir, what you need to get all of that is creativity. It doesn't look easy many times. In many family situations, it looks very difficult. How do I get freedom and joy? But like Meera, like these people, we are more ready now to attain that than we were at Meera's time. Because there is an awakening happening. Goddesses are supporting us. Even men today are a bit different. They're open to these ideas. Even the younger generation, the men are not so patriarchal anymore. So now creativity can be used to create a life where you can have all of it.
Yeah. Sir, actually, you have explained about the joy and love. Using the freedom, the concept of freedom. Yeah, very well explained, sir. Incredible teaching, sir. And you are explaining that use your skills. Skillfully you join the freedom, love and joy. Everything you. So we need some skillfulness. That's more important, sir. Very simply you are explaining.
In our next talk, we'll skillfully choose the name. We'll call it Love, Joy, and Freedom.
Yes, sir. We need skillfulness, actually. We should not leave anything, but with skillfulness, we can be inclusive with everything. Yes.
Exactly. That was Buddha's message. Buddha was all about skillfulness. Skillful means a big topic in Buddhism. Skillful simply means creative, you know. You use your creativity to come up with better solutions, you know, and there are solutions. There are baby circles, family ties that we want to create. We want these places to be places to explore this, you know, this type of wisdom. And then there'll be some deva circles also for men. And then after 2-3 years, we'll have some joy circles also, both men and women. But there is a reason that goddesses want all three to exist. There is some work that is done only in Devi circles, which will be the majority of them. Some spiritual work is done in Deva circles. There are a lot of energies that men cannot talk about with, you know, in a mixed group. They want only like a male energy to surrender to the feminine. They have to talk about, you know, what they're struggling with, about their careers, about their whatever. And then, you know, a bigger evolution happens. Then you can have like a joy circle mixed group where you can talk about these issues. We'll have all three types and they'll all three will be there. But Devi circles will remain the big group, the biggest group in this creation, which is coming soon. So we are working on that. That's why slowly the website, there's an app coming also, Devi app. So there'll be a Devi circle app, which will connect different ways, women in these groups and divine feminine energies. And this is where we can explore, you know, how to be creative and how to energize our lives with more of these energies and different cultures have so many role models, you know. In all cultures, we've had these role models. I mean, there are stories of Mary Magdalene, Jesus' wife, which is so misunderstood, you know. And there are other goddesses are there in all cultures, you know. So we'll explore some of that also. So all that is coming, and I'm very happy with this great partnership we have with the PSSM Global, and the creating
partner.
And spoken to Paramashri Patriji in some time. Soon I'll reach out to him. And you know, we want this is the matriarchal way to have different organizations also working together. So you know, support each other and all of that. You know, they're different paths and they still meet. They're not like, you know, this is against that. You know, we're all, you know, doing the same kind of work, you know. So which is very, very, you know, I feel very fond of this whole path with that we've created, that Patriji's created with PSSM. You know, it's very beautiful. Simply breathing and meditating and vegetarian food and, you know, and loving and Sangha and, you know, it's all so beautiful. It's so much femininity truly is there, you know, in this path.
Yes.
I mean, sir, it is a oneness work.
Oneness work, yeah.
All organizers. So oneness work.
You explained about the law of attraction also very well, sir. If we are fullest, we can get everything through law of attraction also. You explained through the stories of Meera and
Radha.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yeah,
very well explained, sir. So,
great.
So, anybody have any questions or you want to tell any feedback to sir about class?
Okay.
If anybody is there, they can talk.
Thanks.
Say comment.
So we can, sir,
we can close our eyes and meditate for a few minutes.
Yes, sir.
We want to meditate with you, sir. You want to meditate with your great energy? Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, so close your eyes and take a deep breath in and breathe out. And another deep breath in. And feel it all the way in your abdomen. Breathe out. And another breath in. And become empty. Breathe out. And keep feeling your breath in a circular way. Breathing in and breathing out. Feel the weight of your body. See if your back is straight or not straight. See if you're resting in a balanced way on both your sitting balanced. Move yourself left and right and see it's the right balance. And breathe in and breathe out. Whatever sound you are listening to, remove any belief or judgment about the sound. Just a plain sound. Feel the joy in whatever sound is entering from whatever source. It's all joyful. All sounds are joyful. Your body is the center of your infinite soul. You can literally feel the energy field of your soul, of your being. The energy field around you, 10 feet, 20 feet, it's all you. Just more and more emptiness. And that emptiness has fullness. It's your soul going in all directions, infinite. 30 feet, 100 feet. It's you. 100 meters, 200 meters, 1 kilometer. Keep breathing. You're this infinite being, complete emptiness in this soul energy. Goes on 10 kilometers, goes on spreading all over the world. And from this infinite energy field that you are, this body is just in the middle, being supported by your entire soul energy, primordial joy, primordial love, primordial freedom. Your body has got so much power to connect with this energy field. And because the energy field has emptiness, all energy fields become one. We're all one in this energy field. As we go further and further, it's all oneness. It just creates an illusion of separation with your mind, thinking I'm a different body, but you're all the same energy. Keep breathing and surrendering to this infinite version of yourself, the real you, in which we're all, you and me are all I, all of us are one. It's the same I-ness, singular I-ness, which is empty, empty of beliefs. Just oneness of love, oneness of joy, oneness of freedom, and oneness of peace. Keep breathing. Discover the harmony in your breath. Discover the love in your breath. Discover the joy in your breath. And be the body. all of your infinite being, your soul, is filled with divine love and joy and primordial freedom. We're all one. Take another deep breath and breathe out. Feel your toes and your fingers come in your body and gently raise your hands and cup your eyes. And when you're ready, you can open your eyes. Okay. Thank you, everybody. That was a wonderful session. Namaste. Jai Devi Ma. Thank you all.
Sir, thank you so much, sir. Sir, there is a question from Atlanta.
Yeah.
Sheetal Power. She said, thank you so much, sir, for the gratitude. From Sheetal Power, Atlanta. I was in a different mood since yesterday. You reminded me I am real. Such a freedom. Thank you so much, sir. So this was the question from Atlanta, US. Nice freedom, sir. And another question is, sir, namaste, sir. Wonderful narration about the emptiness to infiniteness. And thank you so much. So this was the feedback I have presented, sir.
Thank you.
Really, the session was so wonderful, sir, with your presence and your wisdom. Thank you so much, sir, for coming here for this wonderful narration of emptiness to infinite.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. We could stay on forever, but I think our time is up. So we shall meet again.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much for giving your valuable time, sir. Such a wonderful session, and more than the subject, your presence is more valuable for us, sir. Thank you for being meditating with you, sir. Thank you, and we see other more sessions with you, sir. Thank you for giving us the goddess energy,
sir. Madam,
and
sir,
goddess knowledge also, sir.
Madam, sir, exactly correct, sir. We want to see further more class with you. So yes. Thank you, sir. Meditation was wonderful, and your teaching was very, very nice. Thanks, sir. We feel very grateful and very thankful to you, sir. Dhanyavad. Namaste, sir.
And your compassion coupled with clarity is more inspirational for us, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Today you have connected all of us with the really goddess energy, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye, everybody. Thank you. Namaste.
Bye-bye, sir. Bye-bye. Namaste.